balling toes. I said I want to do a quick 10-minute snippet, and then my mom's like, no, be the main speaker. And I'm just like,
amen.
I just, you know, I'm being obedient, like
okay,
she said.
Amen. Okay, that's all right.
Okay, so I just want to say good morning to everybody. I would like to give honor to my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ,
amen,
and to Pastor and First Lady,
amen,
for this opportunity. I know a lot of you guys are like, what is Derek about to talk about? All right, so I'm up here because I started asking the question, you know, God, what can I do for you?
Amen.
And you know how sometimes you ask a question and then it's like answered already?
Mm-hmm.
So I knew that was the time right now to do what God wanted me to do. I know that God wants me to share the good news.
Amen.
And I knew that I was ready for whatever, except I did not want to speak in front of people. And as you can see, God has a sense of humor. let's see here. I fully understand the harvest is plenteous and the laborers are few.
Uh-huh.
I can labor in everything else, so why not labor in the kingdom of God? Mm-hmm. Not to sound dark and gloomy, but the light is slowly dimming in our world. And Jesus is that light that can reignite us, whether people understand that or not.
Mm-hmm.
I'm also up here because there are so many false doctrines nowadays.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I just want to remind everyone the real gospel of Jesus Christ. Maybe you learned something new that you may have not heard, or you just simply received clarity about salvation. Mm-hmm. So let's get into it. This is the gospel. This is the good news. Mm-hmm. But first, let me read 1 Corinthians 2, 1 through 5 for you. And let me get that turned. Okay, so, and I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of God. For I am determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power, that your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of God.
Mm-hmm.
So I read that to you just so you know, I do not claim to have all the wisdom about the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
But I know and fully understand the gospel of Jesus Christ and how he died for my sins.
Amen.
And that it is very scary up here. And again, I have no enticing words for you,
amen,
today, just scripture only and the word of God.
Amen.
Amen.
That's right.
All right, speaking about God, our Savior, 1 Timothy 2 and 4 says, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of truth? God wants all of us to be saved.
Mm-hmm.
But in order for us to be saved, we have to know what the truth is about salvation, according to the Bible. 1 John 5 and 13 says, these things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. This verse explains that we may know how to obtain life everlasting. I have 6 things that I would like to share with you today so that you know how you may obtain, or how we may obtain, life everlasting with Jesus Christ. Number 1, admit that you are a sinner. Romans 3:10 says, as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one.
Amen.
The word righteous refers to someone who is without wrong, but there is none perfect. Ecclesiastes 7 and 20 says, for there is not a just man upon earth that doeth good and sinneth not.
Mm-hmm.
Romans 3:23 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God.
Amen.
The Bible defines sin as a transgression of the law. The word trans means to cross over.
Mm-hmm.
So we have all crossed over that boundary that God has implemented.
Yes.
If God says I should not lie and I lie, that is a sin. Mm-hmm. If God says I should not steal and I steal, that is a sin. Mm-hmm. Number 2, realize the penalty for sin. Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The Bible says there are wages for our sins. The word wages means payment.
Mm-hmm.
It is something you earn. When we mm-hmm. go to work, what we earn is money. Mm-hmm. And when we sin, what we earn is death.
Amen.
The verse does not refer to a physical death.
That's right.
Revelations 20:14 and 15 says, And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death.
Mm-hmm.
And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. When we die physically, that is the first death or the initial death.
Mm-hmm.
But when an individual is thrown into hell, the Bible calls that the second death. We need to understand that our sin has condemned us all to hell.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Revelation 21 and 8 says, I'm sorry, Revelation 21 and 8 gives a list of who is going to hell.
Mm-hmm.
But the fearful and the unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. That is a pretty horrible list, I know.
Yes.
And most of us have not murdered anyone, I don't think. But we have all lied.
Oh.
The Bible says, let God be true, but every man a liar.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
The point God is trying to make when he adds all liars at the end of the list is so that we can know we have all committed a sin. And even lying is enough to send us to hell. Just a little bit of my testimony. Got to go off script for this. So I wanted to, why I decided to be saved. As a child, I've always wanted to be saved. Around 6 or 7,
mm-hmm.
I did want to be saved. I thought it looked really fun when we went to church and we went to different things like that. And so I always wanted to be saved. But when I was young, and don't make fun of me, but in my little young mind, mm-hmm. I thought that I had to speak tongues in order to be saved. So all around me, I saw people speaking tongues, and I'm just like, okay, I don't have any tongues to speak. So I said God did not want to save me, so I moved on. So that leads me into, as I got older, as I moved on and I got older, I went down another path, the broad way, the destructive way that leads to hell. And by the time I realized that it's not about the tongues, I did not want to surrender. So it then became an issue of I didn't want to surrender to a higher power than me.
Mm-hmm.
So, and surrendering is very hard. It's one of the most hardest things I've had to do, to put your trust into someone mm-hmm. that you barely knew, but I'm growing to know God as I'm growing in Jesus Christ. So.
Yeah.
Amen.
But my last point I would like to make is it was about 4 years ago, because I got saved about 4 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
I had this eerie feeling, and I did not know what it was. It was the weirdest feeling I've ever felt in my life, and I just kept thinking, like, what was that feeling? What was that feeling? And to this day, I always think about what was that feeling. And then I was reading my Bible, and I came across something in Romans 1. Mm-hmm. I'm just going to read with you Romans 1, 28. To 32. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge,
mm-hmm.
God gave them over mm-hmm. to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, malicious, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. Now, with this, I was on this list. And as I read it, I'm just like, maybe that was my eerie feeling. My eerie feeling could have possibly been that God was going to give me over. Because I tell you what, people who know the truth, they have it worse. And I knew the truth. I knew the death, the burial, the resurrection, but I rejected Jesus. I continued to reject him because I did not want to surrender. So I was like, maybe possibly could have been that God was going to give me over to a reprobate mind because I kept rejecting him. Reprobate means to be rejected. And so possibly God was just going to give me over to things that I wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
And when it says in 32, who knowing the judgment of God, I fully understood the judgment of God. I fully understood that I was going to go to hell if I did not accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. But I did not want to do that. I did not want to surrender. I wanted to do what Derek wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to live my life. So I did not want to live the godly Christian life. So I decided to just continue doing what I want to do until I had that feeling. And I tell you, if you ever have that feeling, God is possibly about to give you over. Okay? So I had to make that clear, that if you ever have a feeling that you know you need to start doing what is right, then start doing what is right.
Amen.
So that's just a little bit of my testimony. Number three, accept that salvation is a free gift. Remember Romans 6:23 says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." We now understand what that means. The payment of sin is death, not just the physical death, but the second death, being cast into the lake of fire. The second part of that verse is that God has a gift he wants to give us. And that gift is eternal life, and it is through Jesus Christ. Ephesians 2:8-9 says, "For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." Just a little illustration. I'll put my aunt on blast right now, my Auntie Deborah. She went to Walmart. She loves going to Walmart after she gets off of work. And so she went to Walmart one time, I think around 6 or 7 o'clock, and they had these crazy prices, very, very cheap prices. And she texts me, and she sends me a picture of all this food that she bought me. And I was just like, oh my goodness, thank you so much for that. I really appreciate it. And then she just, in passing, was just saying how much she paid. And I was like, wow, okay, so how much do I owe you? And she was saying that, and I quote, "You owe me nothing. I would never buy first, then say you owe me $50. I bought it for you." And I had to go back to our text messages, because that's exactly what you said. So as soon as I give her even so much as a dollar, I have now earned those groceries. A gift, by definition, is something given voluntarily without payment in return. You cannot pay for it, and you cannot earn it. Not of works, lest any man should boast. Salvation is not something we earn by the way that we live our lives or by being religious. Some people think you have to repent of your sins to be saved or turn away from your sins to be saved in order to go to heaven. That's not so. Here is what we need to understand. Repentance in regards to salvation is going from unbelieving to believing, or going from trusting in the wrong things such as works or religion to save you, and turning from that and trusting on Lord Jesus Christ alone. Number four, believe that Jesus Christ paid for your sin. Romans 5:8 says, "But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." Commendeth means to entrust something to someone. We need to understand Jesus wasn't just a man. He wasn't just a prophet, and he wasn't just a good teacher. Matthew 1:23 says, "Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which being interpreted is God with us. He wasn't just a man. He was God in the flesh. And I'm pretty sure everybody know that, but I don't want to assume anything. John 1:1 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." John 1:14 says, "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." 1 Timothy 3:16 says, "And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh." 2 Corinthians 5:21 says, "For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." These are all references to Jesus being God in the flesh. Jesus came to this earth. He was born of a virgin. He lived a sinless life. He died on the cross, not to pay for his own sins, because he had no sins. Amen. He died to pay for our sins, past, present, and future. He was buried. He rose from the grave 3 days later as a payment for our sins. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life." Number five. Understand that salvation cannot be lost. A lot of people think that they can lose their salvation. That is not the case. Everlasting life is life that will last forever. Or life that will never end. That means if in 5 years from now you decide to kill someone, God will not take away your eternal life. And I know that sounds weird, but let me go into it. Okay. If he does, that means it wasn't forever, and that will make God a liar.
Right. Amen.
Titus 1:2 says, in hope of eternal life, which God, that cannot lie, promised before the world began. So when God makes a promise, he keeps it. But don't think just because we are saved, we can run around killing people. That's not the case. Yeah. On this earth, there are consequences for our sins.
Yes.
On this earth, we will reap what we sow.
Amen.
And on this earth, God does discipline us for our sins.
Yes.
But once God saves us, once he gives us everlasting life, he will never take it away. The beautiful thing about salvation is that when God forgives us of our sins, it's all of them, again, past, present, and future.
Mm-hmm.
All right, last and certainly not least, call number six, call upon Jesus Christ to save you. I'll just give y'all a brief illustration. If I say I'm going to give you a gift, and I went out and bought a car, and I put a bow on it, and some balloons with your name in it, and you say, thanks, but no thanks, and you reject my gift, first of all, you're crazy. But did the car ever become yours? No. Why? Because you did not accept it. Did I pay for the car? Yes, I did, and in full, too.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Was it meant for you? The balloons inside with your name points to yes. But it never became yours because you did not accept it. The gift of God is the exact same way. Jesus Christ already paid for it on the cross, and he offers it all to us for free. We get a choice whether we like to accept it or reject it. Are you going to accept God's free gift?
Yes.
Romans 10 and 9 says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved.
Mm-hmm.
Confess means to admit.
Mm-hmm.
What are we admitting? We are admitting that we are sinners and deserve to die and go to hell. I know it's a tough pill to swallow, and a lot of people are like, I didn't do anything for me to go to hell. But you're going by the world standards. We got to go by God's standards.
Mm-hmm.
So, and believe what? That God has raised him from the dead, the death, the burial, and the resurrection. That his sacrifice was enough to purchase my salvation. Romans 10 and 13 says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It is not just the words that save us.
Mm-hmm.
It's the belief from the heart.
Amen.
Let Jesus believe it in your heart so he knows it's real.
Amen.
Just to recap. Number one, admit that you are a sinner.
Mm-hmm.
Number two, realize the penalty for sin.
Mm-hmm.
Number three, accept that salvation is a free gift. Number four, believe that Jesus Christ paid for your sin.
Mm-hmm.
Number five, understand that salvation cannot be lost.
Mm-hmm.
And number six, call upon Jesus Christ to save you.
Mm-hmm.
Again, this is the gospel. This is the good news. Now run, tell that.
Yeah.